As I was trying to figure out what I was going to talk about this weekend, it was up until yesterday that the Lord finally revealed to me what He wants to teach us this evening. And it's a subject that greatly goes without being taught. It's something that we as Christians are just supposed to know. But the question is, do we really know it at all? The title of this message is called A House Called Prayer. And the foundation of this message is found in Isaiah 56, verse 7. For my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. Do we understand exactly what prayer is? Do we understand its power? It's supposed to be the cornerstone upon which our faith in Jesus is established, the connection between our spirits and the Lord's. It's something that defies all human logic, that our prayers can reach a holy God. It is the most core aspect of why we choose to believe in what we believe in. If you know the story of Thomas, he only believed because he saw the marks in Jesus' hands and his side. And Jesus said to Thomas, "You believe because you have seen. Blessed are those who believe even when they have not seen." Prayer is the ultimate act of the Christian faith. The ultimate act of our belief system. When we gather together and defy all sort of logic to pray. Where's the teaching of it gone? It is our most powerful weapon described within the text of the scriptures. But it's not even an aforethought anymore. With churches and indoctrinations taking the advice of self-help paths to a better life, rather than teaching Christians about the simple and yet profoundly needed weapon of intercessory prayer. Many of us in today's world view the passionate prayer in the church as somewhat of a cultural taboo, because we refuse to realize the desperation that should and must entail the conduit that we use to connect ourselves to God. You see it all the time. When someone is truly baptized in the Holy Spirit and they throw themselves down before the altar in the desperation of their hearts and the desperation of their souls and who they are, people immediately turn their attention to that person. Whether it be with scorn, whether it be with disgust, whether it be with compassion or sympathy, you read throughout the Bible the story of Hannah, Samuel's mother, where she came to pray at the temple. The priest Eli came to her and watched her. She was mumbling words in the spirit. And he said, "Woman, get rid of your wine." And I said, "Forgive me, my Lord. I'm not crazy or I'm drunk. I'm praying before my Lord." It's not taken as normal. Even for a priest, praying before the Father wasn't considered normal, especially when it's through desperation. But we as Christians always use prayer as the last resort. The first point I want to leave with you tonight is, know the power of the weapon of prayer. And in Psalm 107, 28 through 30, "Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. Then they were glad that the waters were quiet, and he brought them to their desired haven." There is no weapon more powerful that has been given to us than the power of prayer. If you recall stories in the Bible of some of the greatest miracles ever performed, whether it be through Moses, whether it be through Elijah, whether it even be through Jesus himself, the miracle came through the power of prayer, because it's the only tool that we use in our spirits to connect ourselves to the Father in a personal and committed fashion. It is the thing that connects us to a personal God. It's not just about throwing words up in the air, but in the desperation of your heart, when you feel like you have no other alternative, when you feel like you can just cry out to the Father, the Bible says that He is near to those who call on His name. It is our ultimate connection, and it represents the ultimate act of surrender to the Lord's power. And yet it is this idea of life spent on the knees that is now taught against in Americanized Christianity. Questions fill our minds of whether the Lord will hear us, that He still hears us. And moreover, will He answer? Do we pray anymore like our life depends on it? Do we? Think of the worst situation that ever happened in your life. I put myself in that mix. Was prayer the one, did it ever occur to your mind? And when you prayed in the darkest moment of your life, did you pray in the agony of your spirit because you felt like there was no alternative? When you couldn't figure out a human practical solution to your problem, what did you do with it? Did you bring it before the Father in urgent prayer? I'll tell you this, the majority of the famous apostles and the prophets and the teachers that were talked about throughout the Bible, in their hour of need, the one thing that they knew they could do above anything else was to cry out to the Lord. In the good times, do we cry out to the Lord in remembrance of His never-ending bounty of blessings, or do we only cry out during the hard times of our lives when the walls are closing in around us? Do we even have faith that He will answer? His house shall be called a house of prayer. James 1:6. But let him ask in faith without doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. If you look throughout the scriptures, some of the greatest miracles that we can ever imagine are described in these texts. But yet we as human beings and as Christians like to put God into a box and try to fit Him into our human logic of what a God should be. We try to box Him into our human explanations. But the greatest thing that we as Christians have done through the beginning when the Israelites came out of Egypt to the early church was when we realized there was no way out except to pray to the Lord, to connect ourselves back to the Father. Because that was our only source of hope throughout the years. What got us through some of the worst circumstances in world history was when the church got together, arm in arm, and they prayed to the Lord. Because they realized that they couldn't figure anything out by themselves. They realized their only hope now was a powerful God. Psalm 91, 1 through 5. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, this is David, I will say to the Lord, he's praying, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For He will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His pinions, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. The greatest battle that we as Christians can ever fight in this life is within the spiritual realm. Only within the spiritual realm. Because the physical you can leave behind for a little while. But the spiritual realm you carry with you no matter where you go. And right now there was a war going on within the spiritual realm, within the forces of darkness and the forces of light over your life. A fierce battle that we cannot see. And the Lord never intended us to be idle in this battle. Just because we have physical skin, we also have spirits now that are within these bodies. And they're feeling the struggle of this warfare. And now you see the spiritual warfare rearing itself in the physical world. And the enemy has done himself good in lulling Christianity to sleep in this nation. The greatest attacks from the enemy come when the people begin to pray. For when we as a church and as a people agree, touching anything on this earth through the power in heaven, the Lord answers and the enemy must flee. You go to the different areas of the world, to the third world countries, and you meet with the churches there. They have nothing that society says that we need in order to live a fulfilled life. All they have is their faith. And when they pray like their life depends on it. And as a missionary to Honduras myself, I've seen some of the greatest transformations that I've ever seen in people's lives. From a small church, a church that is hidden in the mountains somewhere where there's no food and there's no water, but the people there, they pray. And that's where the miracles happen. The same God that is available to the people who live on the other side of the world is the same God who is active in this country. The freedom that we've been given in this country to be able to pray, we've taken it for granted and we become complacent in it. All the while letting the enemy control the narrative now. Whether it's within the church, they try to give you a self-help guide to a better life, to recovery. But they won't teach you how to pray. How to pray. One of the core questions that the disciples asked Jesus, how do we pray, Lord? How do we pray? And Jesus told them, pray like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. That was one of the most important questions that they ever had for Jesus. Because they realized when they saw their master pray, there were miracles that happened. Because it was an abandonment of the human logic and entrusting everything to the power of Almighty God. An abandonment of everything, every kind of human solution that there could be, and you just trust that the Lord is going to do what he promised he's going to do. But do we do that anymore? Do we pray like our life depends on it? There is nothing more dangerous to our faith than a church that sleeps and refuses to activate itself in this spiritual war. You have become so consumed with the physical warfare that we forget the spiritual warfare that is working every single day, night, hour, minute, and second to destroy you. And even with the physical war, we screw that up. First Peter 4:7. The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. In Revelation 3, verse 2, wake up and strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your works complete in the sight of my God. You know, one thing that my father has taught me and my brother our whole lives was that if you got 99.999% of the things in your life right, but if one thing is off in your life, your whole life can be destroyed just from that one thing. And there is nothing more dangerous to a Christian and to a follower of Christ than someone who does not pray. Because the battle is in the spiritual realm. And what the enemy is after, he's not so much after your flesh, because your flesh is already working in cahoots with him. What he's after is your soul. Because it was your soul that Jesus set free, so the enemy wants to do nothing but put it back in bondage. Under his control. Look at the narratives now, with pastors in the churches and evangelists everywhere teaching about everything else except the power of prayer. Our pastor, Jim Cimbala from Brooklyn Tabernacle, once gave a famous message at a pastor's conference some years ago. The name of this message was called, "My House Will Be Called a House of Prayer." And one of the things that he said is that when he was talking to some well-known pastors and ministers, he said, "Pastor Jim, everything is going well, everything is going fine, people are coming, but it's interesting, something is wrong, because anytime I call anyone to come inside the church other than a Sunday service on a Sunday morning, no one comes. I guarantee you that if I were to call a prayer meeting," Pastor Cimbala said, "not one-tenth of the congregation would come. Not one-tenth. They're willing to drop $20 for a big name gospel singer, but Jesus can't draw the crowds." Imagine what would happen if the church collectively did what Jesus said, if we were taught to have faith as small as a mustard seed. The way we move mountains is through prayer. When Elijah called down fire from heaven in the face of the 400 prophets of Baal who were laughing at him, it was through prayer that Elijah called down fire from heaven. He didn't just hurl up words in the air. He said, "My God, show them that you are God, that you are a mighty God, and that you're working and that you're alive in Israel." And that's when the fire from heaven came down and consumed the sacrifice and even lapped up the water that was surrounding it. It was when men and women prayed in faith that the greatest miracles happened. When they prayed in the authority of the Holy Spirit, you think it's just limited to the older adults and the people that have been Christians for 30 plus years? No, let me tell you something. For the children and the young people that are here, let me tell you something. You have an advantage over us as those who are older, because there's nothing inhibiting you. That's why Jesus said, "Be like the little children," because they're pure in heart. You have a greater access to God than most of us who have been through life, because there's nothing inhibiting you. That's why Jesus said to be like the little children, because of a pure heart that calls out to the Father. The second point I want to leave with you tonight is to know the great theft. Yes, there is thievery going on in today's church. Matthew 21:13. He said to them, "The scriptures declare my temple will be called a house of prayer, but you have turned it into a den of thieves." Let me tell you something. There is no greater thievery that has taken place within the church of Christ than the leaders, the people who know the truth, depriving people of the right to learn how to pray. We consume ourselves with an agenda and with an idea that we can fulfill our good deeds on Sunday and then abandon the Lord during the week. Rinse and repeat. But do we pray? Do we cry out in the anguish of our spirits? My dad says so himself. The Sunday service is the Sunday service, but the most important service of the week is our prayer service. Why? Because the people that come to the prayer service are the people that are hungry for more. Are hungry when they come to the altar. So, "Lord, I am not satisfied with just a Sunday service. I want to join together and receive a word from you. I am not satisfied just sitting at home waiting for the next bill to come or for the next trial to come or the next tribulation to come. I need to put my armor on, Lord. I need to be girded up with the full armor of God, because the enemy is going to attack my soul. He's after my very soul." And you see it now across the whole world today. The soul is being attacked. And the only way that we can attack back is through prayer. That's why Jesus said, when confronted by Pilate, he said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight for me. But my kingdom is of another place. My kingdom is in the spirit." So we fight in the spirit. We pray in the spirit. When I was going through my season in my life, when I was falling away from the Lord, I thought, well, I was a lost cause. I started to sin against the Lord. I started to do horrible things that I felt damaged who I was, basically made me unreachable. I was a lost cause. I was incorrigible. I was unable to come out from where I was. I might as well have just been left to die. But it was when I realized that I couldn't figure out anything on my own, that I got down on my knees again and I cried out unto my Lord. And in that moment, when I finally stopped fighting and surrendered myself to the Lord and said, Lord God, I have no answers. You have the answer. You are the author of my life. You know the beginning and the end. So I'm entrusting myself to you. Now take me out. Take me out of this season that I'm in and restore me. And I'm here today because I prayed finally and stopped fighting. If there is any need, do we lift it before the Lord as the body of Christ, unified in spirit? Do we storm the gates of heaven anymore with tears staining the ground for those who do not know the truth of the Lord's love and his freedom? For if Jesus made it absolutely clear to call out the Pharisees and religious leaders and the money changers who were scamming the congregants by saying that his house shall be called a house of prayer, why aren't we praying? We have given over the temples of our hearts to thieves by the doctrines we accept in today's society. Let me tell you something. Where the Spirit lives, where Jesus is concerned with, is your heart. That's why Paul says, our bodies are the temples of the Holy Spirit. And if Jesus says, my house shall be called a house of prayer, then our hearts, which are the temples of the Holy Spirit, should be consumed with the prayers and the utterances in the Spirit that cannot be determined by any kind of human understanding. If we give over our hearts to the thieves, the enemy has succeeded in his mission to capture us and to render us useless because we've refused to pray. You read throughout the scriptures. You read it throughout from the front to back, from Genesis all the way to Revelation. It was when the church prayed that a miracle would happen. And some of the areas where we realize, you know what? I can't figure it out, Lord. Lord, this situation, it's too big for me. I can't get a grasp around it. I'm just going to surrender it up to you, Lord, and trust that you're going to answer. How about this? How about even just praying and thanking God for the things that he has already done for you already? You're here today, aren't you? Death hasn't gotten a hold of you. You're still fighting. You're still standing strong. That means the Lord is keeping you persevering. You are not weak. Yet the Lord has given you open access to him. When Jesus said it was finished, he said that the temple was torn in two of the temple. No longer did you have to go to a priest or a pastor to confess yourself to him. You have open access to the Father. Jesus says that I call you heirs of a royal priesthood. You've been given the right to be called sons and daughters of the living God. What kind of father would he be if he did not make himself openly available to his children? Then why aren't we talking to him? Shouldn't we be calling out to him for every aspect of our lives, no matter how big or how small it is? If he is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, if he exists outside of time, let me tell you something. There is nothing that you can go through that God is not able to overcome. Because Jesus said himself, to fear not, for I have overcome the world. There is nothing that is able to bind God to anything. If he is freedom in and of itself, then as sons and daughters of freedom, you are free to pray and call out to the Father. There is nothing that inhibits you, only that the enemy that's trying to spit lies into your mind, telling you that the Lord is incapable of answering. You really believe that? You really believe that something that defies science and logic will be able to get you out of the situation that you're in? You're going to die in this unless you take some sort of human action. And then you render yourself useless because you go around in circles and circles again like the Israelites did. 40 years in the desert they walked around because they couldn't get it. It's something so simple and yet it's so powerful, and we get it wrong every single time, myself included. And the third point I want to leave to you. Cry out to God for he is near to those that call on his name. Acts 4:23-31. When they had been released, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. This is when Peter and John had just been captured and they had just been released after being told not to speak the name of Jesus. Right after they had been released and threatened, they went back to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard this, they lifted their voices to God with one accord and said, O Lord, it is you who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said, why did the Gentiles rage and the people devise futile things? After being threatened with their very lives, the very first thing they did was nothing else but to first give thanks to God, because they said, there is no human device that can be created that will be able to deter me. The Bible says that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. So nothing that comes out of the mouth of man, nothing that comes out of the mouth of the devil will be able to deter you. For God is your ultimate ally. We were singing it before. He is the great commander. And what kind of commander would he be if he was not one to give orders to his generals and to his soldiers to go out into the battlefield and fight on their knees in prayer? We don't fight with the physical weapons of this world. We fight through the words of our spirit, through the desperation of who we are. We cry out to the Lord and we petition him, Lord, give me a spirit that is conformed to yours so that I may commune with you day in and day out, because I can't understand this life, but you're going to lead me through because your word promised me so. Let me tell you something. There is no request too big or too small that the Lord does not take into account. None. I can tell you that because I'm here today because of a small prayer that I uttered in the darkness of my heart and the darkness of my situation. I uttered a little prayer. God, save me. And I'm here today because he heard me. If any of you need provision, pray. For the Lord is Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord will provide. If any of you need healing, pray. For the Lord is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. If any of you need victory in your life, pray, for the Lord is Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner. If any of you need to feel his presence, pray, for the Lord is Jehovah Shammah, which means the Lord is here. If any of you need peace, pray, for the Lord is Jehovah Shalom, which means the Lord our peace. If any of you need sanctification, pray, for the Lord is Jehovah Mekadosh Shikem. The Lord who sanctifies you, Jehovah Mekodishkim. If any of you need righteousness, pray, for the Lord is Jehovah Sitkanu, the Lord our righteousness. If any of you need protection, pray, for the Lord is Jehovah Rohi, the Lord our shepherd. If any of you need an army, pray, for the Lord is Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts, the great commander. I needed an army. I needed an army that was going to fight in the spirit for me because I was too weak. In that moment, I felt like Elisha when he was trapped in a town surrounded by the men of Aram. And his servant looked up to him and said, Lord, look how many they are. We're surrounded. There's no way. And Elisha said, oh Lord, open my servant's eyes that he may see. And when he opened his eyes, there before him was the entire army of the Lord cloaked in fire, even more numerous than the armies that were standing against them, waiting to be commanded by Elisha to go and strike the Arameans with blindness because they dared raise their hands against the anointed of the Lord. Once you accept Jesus Christ into your hearts, let me tell you something. You bear on yourself the marks of Christ. And anyone in the spirit or in the physical world who raises their hand against you, the Lord takes that into account and comes to your aid when his people cry out to him in the spirit. The Lord wants nothing more than to commune with you because it's the only way that you survive, not for his benefit, but for yours. Because if we do not connect to the Lord, who is life in and of itself, our spirits are being led across the road to destruction and death. If it is the Lord who gives life, why in the world don't we want to connect to life? After I wrote this message, you know what happened to me? I fell on my knees. I fell on my knees. And the Lord hit me in my heart in a way that he hasn't done in a long time. But he made me realize my shortcomings and coming to before him with prayer. And then for the first time in a long time, my heart broke for the things that broke his. And I got down and I wept before the Lord. And the only things that I could say in the utterances of my spirit is that they don't know. They just don't know. Your people, Lord, they just don't know. They're out there slaughtering themselves. And they just don't know. They don't know, my God. My God is a God of love. My God is a God of peace. My God is a God of restoration. My God is a God who forgives. My God is a God of grace. My God is a God who talks to his people. They just don't know. You can imagine when Jesus felt when they were crucifying him. He said, Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. We go throughout our lives aimlessly, trying to think that we're just here just to make our money throughout the week, retire, and then die. That's what life is according to society. But the Lord says that he's called us to a greater and better purpose. The atheists and the materialists will argue that there is no such thing as purpose for your life. I refuse to believe that. I wouldn't be here today if I didn't realize that the Lord had given me a purpose in this life. And I didn't realize this purpose until I dropped everything, stopped trying to problem solve everything, and call out to my God in the simpleness of who I was. And I didn't have to come before him anywhere else. I didn't have to clean myself up like the high priest would have to do before he entered into the most holy of holy place. I came just as I am, warts and all, dirt and all, mud and all. And because of the cross, the blood of Jesus washed away my sins, which were like crimson, and made me as white as snow, and restored me again, just like he restores anyone else who believes in the name of Jesus and who calls upon his name. For the Bible says that he will defend his name for his name's sake. For his name is life. His name is peace. His name is victory. His name is freedom. Now there's a story in the Bible, in the book of Acts, but the story of the Apostle Peter. He had been arrested by Herod and was thrown in prison. And one night, before Herod was to bring Peter to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with chains. And there were sentries that stood guard at the entrance. And suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Then the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes and sandals." And Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me," the angel told him. And Peter followed him out of the prison. But he had no idea at that time that it was an angel of the Lord that appeared to him. He thought it was just a vision. They passed by the guards, and he went up to the iron gate that led into the city, and it opened by itself. And they went through. And then the angel had left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I know without a doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were hoping would happen." When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, "Peter is at the door." "You're out of your mind," they told her. But Peter kept on knocking. And when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter had motioned them with his right hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. You know what was happening during Peter's time in that prison? I'll tell you exactly what was going on. In Acts 12, verse 5, "So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him." Because the church was willing to stop looking for any kind of human solution to this problem, they knew what was going to happen to Peter. They knew that he would be condemned and ultimately to death. But it was when the church realized that now is the time to pray earnestly with tears staining the ground so we could see our brother set free. And little did they know that God was in the process of working forth one of the greatest miracles ever described in the Bible about setting Peter free from a high security prison and having him walk right past the guards into freedom because people were willing to pray. The last point I want to leave with you today is to pray in anguish. What does anguish mean? The Webster Dictionary definition describes anguish like this: extreme pain or distress. Have you ever felt in a time in your life when you just felt nothing but extreme pain and distress, something that was felt like it was tearing you from the inside out and you felt like you were going to explode? In Luke 22:44, talking about Jesus when he was praying at the Mount of Olives, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Can you imagine praying like that? In the desperation of your heart, that you will come to the place where you are so desperate and in need of God that you would pray to the point that sweat would begin to fall down your face, that tears would stream down your face, because you knew that there was no other solution than for you to get down on your hands and knees and to pray in the anguish of your spirit. When you feel like there's nothing else, let me tell you something. True joy, true answers, true miracles comes out of the anguish of our spirit. David Wilkerson even gave a message on this years ago, talking about a call to anguish. "There is no sign of anguish," David Wilkerson said. "There was no sign of anguish anymore, which is why the church has fallen asleep. Because the people refuse to pray and to connect themselves back to the Father." This church was built because of people who prayed in anguish, seeking God's will. The only reason why we're here today is because we're people who have committed ourselves to praying in anguish. And now I pray myself, Lord, make me a man of anguish. And when people will see me, they will see the brokenness of who I am because of your word that has been revealed inside my heart, that has been buried within my heart, that makes me broken for the things that break your heart. Imagine praying in that kind of pain, where your heart is so conformed to the things of the Holy Spirit that when you look at things that break God's heart, it begins to wrench you inside as well. The Bible says that Jesus is interceding for us day and night before the Father. He's still praying for us. The Holy Spirit is interceding for us with words that cannot be understood, praying in anguish. The Holy Spirit still prays within our hearts with anguish. And with trembling, with a broken heart, because he knows how much the enemy has come after each and every one of our lives. The Bible says that we do not have a high priest who was unable to sympathize with us, but was in all points tempted as we were, yet was without sin. We take that and then we just kind of skim over it. But do we really realize what it means when Jesus said that we do not have a high priest who was unable to sympathize? If Jesus became sin in and of itself, the anguish of his heart for his people caused him to abandon everything. Everything about his glory, everything about who he was, everything about his prowess, everything about who he was as God, because of a foolish love. And when the anguish of his spirit that caused him to abandon everything to save a people that hated him. And even when he was nailed to the cross, the only thing he said was, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. They have no idea what they're doing. Think about it now. Many of us are here now today because someone took the time to pray for you in the anguish of their spirit. My parents are here today because people took the time to pray in the anguish of their spirit, in the brokenness of their heart, in the pain and the agony of their heart. David Wilkerson said, until I am in agony, until I have been baptized in anguish, until I've been baptized in the anguish of the Lord's heart, that I may look and that I may see that for every person that I walk past, for every car that drives by me, for every person who does me wrong, that I will look at them and my heart would break. And I would, Lord, they just don't know. They don't know you. They don't know your love. That you would come to the point where you'd be like Jesus did. Someone raises a gun to your head, and all you could do is look at them and say, Lord, they don't know. They don't know that they don't have to do this. They don't know that they've been forgiven. They don't know that they don't have to live like this. They don't know that they've been set free. They don't know that you died on the cross. They don't know that they can approach you in prayer. They just don't know. I spent my life, Lord, trying to compensate for my mistakes in the past by making it my mission to tell people about the truth. Truth became my driving force. And in the process, I could get very animated. But it wasn't until the Lord broke me and made me realize and see things through his eyes that instead of with anger that the Lord sees the things that are going on within this world and the evil and the darkness that is corrupting our world today, instead of looking at it with anger, he looks at it with anguish. That he would weep over his people who just don't know, who don't know him. Think of our God, the God of all creation, weeping. Because even after all he's done, and sacrificing himself on the cross, there are people who still don't know and still spit on the cross. Crucifying him, and again and again and again. I tell people this all the time. With the way I lived my life growing up, in my teenage years, up until a few years ago, I might as well been the one that nailed Jesus to the cross. And I realized how much the Lord's heart was broken because of how much I had abolished everything that I knew about him and left it for the things of this world. But when I returned to Jesus, he didn't just receive me back, but he allowed me to look back at what I left behind. And for the first time, I saw everything that he was seeing. A world that was falling apart because they don't know of his love. And they don't know of his mercy. They don't know of his grace. They don't know of his power. They don't know that we're no longer condemned. If only we would just talk to him again. And I could just talk to my God and petition, Lord, if nothing else, just make my heart break for the things that break yours, that it may drive me more to my knees to pray on behalf of your people. Like the high priest who goes into the Holy of Holy places and takes everything of Israel with him and makes a sacrifice before the Lord. If we're all heirs to a royal priesthood, we all should be entering into the most holy of holy places. And weeping before the Lord on behalf of the people who don't know that he has forgiven everyone. He has forgiven all. It's such a simple truth, but we've refused to accept it because it's so simple. And we try to find human practical solutions to figure everything out. That's why we have agendas in the church now. But where is the anguish of the Spirit that drives us to our knees, that drives us into the prayer closet, that drives us into the war room? That's why I thank God that I could come before my service, my church on a Tuesday night and just pray with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Because I know me. I know that unless I'm not driven, unless I'm not disciplined to approach the Lord in prayer, I won't. But when I enter and I break past that barrier to enter onto my knees, and the Lord, I flatten myself out before the Lord. So, Lord, you know my dirtiness, you know my sin, you know my mistakes. I'm going to pour my heart out before you right now, and I'm going to go and I'm going to pray over someone else who needs you. I'm going to pray over that brother over there who's suffering. I'm going to pray over that sister over there who just lost her family member or something. I'm going to pray, Lord, who do you want me to pray for next? Because I realize the anguish of the Lord's heart. And I realize how much his heart has been broken over the things that have gone on within his people and with the things that are going on in this world. It breaks his heart. So why shouldn't my heart be broken? Why shouldn't our hearts be broken over the things that break his heart? Let me show you a prayer of anguish. In Psalm 22, this is David speaking. This is one of the greatest examples of a prayer of anguish. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me? So far from my cries of anguish. My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the one Israel praises. In you our ancestors put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried out and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. You brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you. Even at my mother's breast, from birth, I was cast on you. From my mother's womb, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions that tear their prey open with their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword. My precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lion. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will declare your name to my people. In the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to the cry of his for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him. Those who cannot keep themselves alive, posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to a people yet unborn, he has done it. Pray in anguish. Learn, I don't care how old you are. You could be 10 years old. You could be 80 years old. Pray in anguish. Pray in anguish. Don't just hurl up words up to the Lord. You think he hasn't heard words already? He wants your heart. He wants your heart. Because he wants you to be broken over the things that break his heart. He wants you to see. He wants you to see his love, his mercy, his grace, his power, his authority. Anguish is available to anyone who is willing to be baptized by him. You don't need to be a Christian for 50 years. It is available to you now because the Holy Spirit lives within your hearts. And if Jesus said, my temple, my house shall be called a house of prayer, then your heart shall be called a house of prayer because your hearts are the temples of the Holy Spirit.